But first, as with every Bond movie, interchangeable far-flung locations are a staple of each story. And for Solace, that meant more globetrotting than any of its predecessors.
I chose, six countries where we were basically shooting at Panama, Chile, Mexico, Italy, Austria, and England, London. And in all those countries, I was looking basically, I found sort of for me iconic Bond locations, because locations in Bond films are sort of characters in themselves, and they have sort of this emotional tapestry in themselves. So it was really important to find these really beautiful and interesting locations across the world.
I need a passport and matching credit card.
And MI6 ran out of plastic.
Well, again, it was Mark who was, insistent on it, and I think it was absolutely the right decision. Watching Bond films as a kid, whether or not the ones that are running on the television or going to the cinema and seeing them, it was always about the locations to a degree. And they did that very early on with the movies. That's kind of as much part of the Bond movies as anything, as part of the Martinis and the Aston Martins.
It gets harder and harder because the world gets smaller, people travel more, they're more familiar with the internet. So you find these stunning locations which you just hope that they allow you to shoot there. And like at the beginning, the producer said, you really want to go there as well? And I said, yes, we need to. I mean, look, it will pay off. You need that kind of aesthetic and look for the film. It will make it feel bigger and more interesting and engaging to an audience.
Hold on! You know that?
Transporting people to these places, that's part of it's part of the character of the film. Finding these locations that are out of the way and look amazing on screen is crucial. It's also, it's also great to travel to them. I mean, Jesus, it's great to work in the places. How long have I got?
30 seconds.
Well, that doesn't give us a lot of time, does it?
Medrano can't move until he pays off the army and the police chief. Green's bringing him his money now. A hotel called the Perla de las Dunas.
Both Mark and I said we just want to make a really beautiful film. So let's go to great locations and photograph them.
Thank you, Felix.
James, move your ass.
And completing the Bond cocktail is returning composer David Arnold, who scored the four previous 007 movies and whom this time enlisted the help of a unique duo to provide the eagerly anticipated theme tune.
Gets you in the mood.
A lot of the time, when you're writing music for a Bond film, you're kind of looking at it from a certain distance. For this one, there's a lot of ambiguity emotionally in the film, the theme of, who you can trust and who you can't trust. And so there's a lot of internal kind of energy for the first time, so a certain amount of it became designing sounds which felt like they were coming from somewhere sort of deep inside.
I'll just build up parts one at a time, and then on top of that, start putting brass on, putting woodwind on. And so this is like a synthetic version of what the orchestra will be playing.
Jack White and Alicia Keys are performing the song, and Jack wrote and produced it. What's intriguing about it was the idea that why would those two ever get together?
And that's where new ideas generate. You take two things that aren't supposed to be together and you mix them up, and then something new happens. I'm not the ringer with the slick
trigger finger for her majesty. It's kind of his dark style that I'm able to join into, and then there's my kind of belting, strong, soulful scatting over it, and harmonies that blare up, and so we both were able to throw our mixes in there and create the gumbo.
Movie scores are become very elaborate and grandiose. I was trying to break it down to something a lot more direct and from the gut.
that's
cool. Nice. Oh, that's fun.
So, with the movie wrapped and ready for release, Mark Forster is relieved the pressure of directing one of the most highly anticipated sequels of 2008 is over.
The pressure is so intense and the workload is so intense that I did enjoy it tremendously, but at the same time, after a day of shooting, I still go back into my hotel room and I'm still have to open my laptop and look at the latest cut of the editors and give my notes and work on the edit, because we only have 6 weeks to cut the movie once I completed principal photography. So the you are constantly working and you basically don't have a life. You just live in this sort of world of Bond, and that's all the world there is. And it gets very, you know, in a sense, you start to forget to breathe. And I just have to remind myself, you have to breathe, because you start to start breathing shallow, and you're not really living life anymore. And that was, you know, in the same time, I'm so happy I did the movie. I'm so happy I lived through it. But I'm really even more than ecstatic to have my life back.
In Italy, the 2nd Unit make a start in the dramatic opening car chase. Garda's winding lakeside roads are one of two locations planned to stage the sequence.
You know, one of the big challenges of this chase was that we're on these two-lane roads. And it's very, very hard to shoot a chase, you know, with just two lanes available. You know, we took a look at the ultimate arm, and it's a remote crane mounted to the top of a high-speed vehicle.
This is a 5-axis gyro-stabilized remote control crane. We can obtain speeds of 200 kilometers an hour.
Okay, we're ready to shoot here.
We're able to get inches away from the action safely.
Action vehicle department has been doing a pretty phenomenal job. Cars will be dragged off the set, and 2 hours later, you know, they come back, you know, running again. So if you count the redos, we probably wrecked 14 Aston Martins.
The second location for the chase was on the snaking roads of Carrara's stunning marble quarry.
It is a tricky situation here because dusty, slippery, and also like all the roads are sort of paved with big slabs of marble. So if you get it wrong, there's no sort of forgiving.
Hello, I'm Michael Wilson, producer of The Quantum of Solace. Over the next few weeks, you'll be seeing on this website several blogs coming in from members of our crew. They're the people that actually do the work, the hard work, day to day. You'll have people from like the unit nurse or one of our assistant directors or people from the art department. And they'll be telling their stories, how it is to be on location with our film. I hope you enjoy it.
My name is Cliff Fleming. I'm the helicopter support pilot and camera helicopter pilot. We help support the ground cameras by carrying the ground cameras and their crew out in positions. We sling load the nets full of camera equipment and survival equipment in case for some reason we can't get them off the top of the mountains. We take out about 4 or 5 passengers at a time with the helicopter and put them in the remote sites.
Help! Help!
We didn't realize that the sites were going to be quite so remote, and the only way to get in and out is that by using the helicopter. the upper positions are we've ranged from anywhere from 1,000 feet to 3,000 foot peaks. About enough room to put the skids down on a rock top, and then the crews get out safely, and then close the doors, and I fly away, leaving them there.
My name is Michael Lerman. I'm the first assistant director on Quantum of Solace.
Let's roll sound, we're rolling.
A lot of people view the first assistant director as kind of the taskmaster on set, the person that's cracking the whip and pushing the crew.
It's not good enough.
My goal on a day-to-day basis is to achieve everything the director wants in the allotted time.
We'll do this with the crowd. Action!
The first thing I do is I take the script and I break it down.
The next sequence is what happens in the Grand Hotel.
All of the cast, the props, the stunts, the special effects.
This is the area here where in the script, the railing.
And while I'm doing that, we're going to numerous locations trying to pick just the right one, you know, that fits all the requirements that the scene dictates.
Talking about painting all of these buildings white to try to match one of our other locations. We'd probably be here for about half a day and be importing in about 50 American-looking extras for this scene.
I've done a lot of movies where the end of the movie, the finale of the movie, is the big set piece. And on this movie, it seems we have one of those sequences every week. It never stops.
Action!
You're never in a room with two people talking for that long.
Mark has asked me to be a waiter in this scene, but I did say if I'm gonna appear in front of the camera, then I wanna be shot.
3, 2, 1, action!
My name's Ben Cook. I'm a stuntman, and I pretty much take care of Daniel. I start 6 to 8 weeks before principal shooting. Gary tells us what he sort of wants. We go away and prepare things, get Daniel in there working with the stunts. We want it to have a certain look and a feel, and you know, we want it to be sort of a realistic, brutal, but someone who's still obviously got the training as well, you know, and we weren't afraid for Bomb to get hit. He's probably got 3 to 4 doubles. There's a few reasons why he would have a number of doubles. You know, there's two units running, there's people that have got better skills and different fields, specialists, because you know you're pushing things to the limit, so you want to get the right person for the job.
So what I want you to do, right, is as we come in and we hit the brakes, I want you to fly forward, right, straight into Marvin, do the fight as we did, as we rehearsed, okay? So that'll be the shot, yeah? Good. All right, we're good with that? Okay, stand by, we're ready to do this. Let's turn over, let's roll the cameras. Go for it.
My name is Terry Bamber. I'm the second unit production manager. Julie, bring my phone. Phone never stops ringing when you're trying to do worksheets, you're trying to work out a plan to, what did I say? Got a wonderful team on the production. In fact, in the second unit production office, it's virtually run without my help. Some might say in spite of me. I mean, look at my desk. I'll have to ring him back. Oh, it's gone. Yeah, no, the green screen for the big... And then I need you up here as soon as I can. I'm here on my own. Judy's tied up with everything. Hannah's not really doing much help. I need help here. It is very stressful. I tend to cope with a little bit of Coca-Cola now and again. And straggly telly ice cream is a very good way.
Adam, I'm trying to make a film here.
Are you getting interviewed?
No, I'm not getting interviewed. I'm actually doing some work. Camera happens to be rolling while I'm doing some work. Will you please go and see Mark about the DVD? Never employ your godson. Q-A-C-I-A-P-A-U-N-N-A-I-L-O-N. See, the trouble is, this computer is, I've done so much work on it, that all the keys have rubbed away, so I can't tell where the N and the M is. It's pure guesswork. And then people say to me, why don't my emails make any sense? Barbara Broccoli, our producer, a wonderful, wonderful lady, has said that she won't ever employ me again. But I can understand that.
My name is Kevin Haug, and I'm the visual effects designer on Quantum of Solace. Visual effects are kind of the glue department. Everything that's impossible becomes our problem. The goal, I think, is primarily to do as much of it in camera as you can, and yet get the most exciting shots you can get. We had to do a number of falls. There are supposed to be 50-foot long falls, and there's only 25 feet to fall in. If it's 25 feet and you fall down to the end of this thing, you only have like 8 feet to go. Why don't you jump? Well, so you have to add another 30 feet. So it doesn't look like you just want to jump, because we can stretch out the set. It's still kind of a monster shot, because it's falling from the top of a set where you see Sienna in the background, and then you fall through the glass. The glass is all real, but they hit, but everything else about it is CG. And then they fall through onto a real set with a CG set behind it, and all these handoffs as you go. They really did that stunt. It just didn't happen there.
What defines Bond? It's those aggressive trumpet stabs, that slightly jazzy drum sound. It's a soaring string line. It's rich, lustrous trombone and French horn chords. It's that evil, dark, twangy guitar. You know, all of those things, I think, would suggest, you know, the sound of James Bond. That theme, I think, somehow tells you that he is going to be victorious. You know, that he's gonna win. If you play it in a scene where he's in any real danger, it kind of dissolves any tension because you're just waiting for him to get out of it. The reason why we didn't do it on Casino Royale, obviously, is because he hadn't earned it at that point. You know, he hadn't become James Bond that had earned and deserved that music.
Bond may still be working to earn his theme, but he's certainly working it in his suit.
When is the next flight to London?
Tomorrow morning.
Well, then we have all night.
I was very anxious that we would have a really strong look for Daniel, because I wanted to do those sort of 60s mohair tonic suits with quite tight waists and big long vents at the back and straight trousers. I wanted it to be quite a tight silhouette.
Quantum of Solace is somehow more direct. You know, it's less concerned with the trappings at the side. You know, it's less concerned with detail, and his eye is always on. Where am I going and what do I have to do? What's the job? And everything else is kind of contained, and then occasionally it will explode. And so the music definitely follows the contours of the character, but I think, you know, the success of the character in this film and the last one is largely down to Daniel's performance.
And with a leaner sound comes a leaner, more streamlined 007.
This time round, his trainer trained him slightly differently so that they knew the limits of what would look great being muscular, but not throw a suit out. If you throw it out, if you've got too many muscles, you'll have the shoulders and then bulgy bits here, which in order to correct them, you have to make the shoulders wider and then you look ludicrous. So, I mean, they kind of trained his body to be brilliant for a suit. You know, it took us forever to get exactly the right white shirt. And when you look at it, it'll look very simple, but to get there, it's sort of three or four different collar looks. You know, we're just testing until you get it absolutely right. The right buttons, the right fabric, the right cuffs, all of that. I would hate to dress an actor and impose the stuff from outside. It's got to come from inside of them. If somebody doesn't like their clothes, you can tell in a second, because even if you force them to wear them, they'll sort of... But Daniel gets it, he really does.
I've made deliberate attempts to move it forward in certain places and to be quite retro about it in others. And I think you can accept the moving forward bit if you have the kind of safety net of you know, this sounds like perhaps it used to, therefore the next part, which doesn't sound like it used to at all, somehow you're kind of more readily prepared for something else to happen.
Get down!
When you write music for a film, you look for the truth in everything, and if it's not true, it's fraudulent, and people can tell when it's fraudulent. And when you write music, people can tell when it's fake and when it's fraudulent. And so all of a sudden I find myself looking at a film that I believe and I believe in, and I believe that that character exists. And that just made it that much easier.
Friend of yours?
I don't have any friends.
We didn't settle on a price.
Make me an offer.
We can work it out later. Over drinks. Dominic didn't give you any trouble, did he?
No.
What the hell is this?
I think someone wants to kill you.
Principal photography on Quantum of Solace began on the 7th of January this year. And with this autumn's worldwide release and immovable deadline, the cast and crew didn't have time to dawdle on a shoot which took them to six different countries, more than any other in the history of the Bond movies. However, substantial elements of the film were shot at 007's home from home, Pinewood Studios in Buckinghamshire. And it was there that I joined director Mark Forster, whose distinguished and diverse CV includes Monsters Ball, Finding Neverland and The Kite Runner, along with his cast and crew as they tackled the job in hand. Mark, lovely to meet you here. This is so exciting for me to be down on the Bond set. Now, you've had a very varied and successful CV as a director, but nothing that immediately screams Bond movies to me. So many might have thought you were an unusual choice. How did you feel when they approached you?
I thought they got the wrong director first. I was sitting there and said, are you sure I'm the right director for this? But the thing is, I always was a Bond fan. I loved the early Bond especially. And I thought I like to jump from genre to genre. So it was really, I thought, another chapter in my sort of as a filmmaker and another challenge to do something I haven't done before.
Eon Productions are quite well known for keeping the same people with them, movie after movie. They have a team they trust and designers and so on. How is it for you being the newcomer in their group?
It was really good. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to do a film is because I met with Barbara Broccoli and Michael Wilson, and they allowed me to bring some of my own people and change some of the people that had worked in the past, which was really important to me because I have my little family I bring along, and they wanted sort of a different vision and expanded the vision from Casino Royale.
One member of the Forster family climbing aboard the good ship Bond is Oscar-winning production designer Dennis Gasner.
Come on in. So we're inside the Pola Lagunas set that obviously has been exploded, and it was designed to explode and motivate our James Bond character to this section.
At the moment we're doing the final sequence, which is the destruction of the villain's lair, if you like. In all the walls are these fuel cells, and they start this chain reaction of explosions all the time while Bond and Camille and the villain are having their little fights.
Well, today is one of the last scenes of the movie, and it's a big fight, basically. We're all in fights. We've been training for a long time for this fight. You know, we're fighting for real. These are fake, but I'm not going to show you the ones that are real.
They sort of play up to it, but they love it, sort of thing, you know. You know, after we say cut, the enjoyment on their face, knowing that they was in there. You know, the training is hard, and it can sort of wear you down, sort of thing. But, you know, we both, you know, or they both know what they sort of let themselves in for, you know.
I had no idea what was waiting for me. They told me, we're going to train you. I thought, oh, okay, you know, I'll do a few exercises, but that's not what they meant. They actually really meant it. You know, because usually people exaggerate when they tell you something like that. But this was, they didn't exaggerate at all.
Daniel always jokes about it, sort of things like, you know, why am I doing this and not the stunt double? But he actually really does enjoy doing it.
You had to do it. It was 45 feet in the air. It was probably 16 feet dropping, you know, 8 into a balcony. He's not terribly comfortable with heights, I don't think. And so my admiration for him only increases. Delivering a good product, I think, is really important for him, you know, sort of his duty to his fans.
I think on Bond films, they want to try and do as much as they can for real, and they always dream up, you know, different challenges.
It's 1977 brand spanking Aston Martins.
Car chases and boat chases.
This is going to be so much fun.
A really nice sequence in a DC3.
We've done our utmost to smash the out of
them. Big explosions.
Give them a pile of spare parts. Yeah, thank you very much.
Nearing the end now, it must be quite nice to see the end in sight. Confident, happy with what you've achieved?
I'm very happy with the movie so far, and I hope people will love it, and I hope they will, you know, like it as much as Casino Royale, or more, hopefully, who knows. But I think it's just, basically, I feel very good about the dailies when I watch it. I think that the character moved on, and I think it will be an exciting film.
One final thing, there's still time for you to change the title, of course. Thunder Pussy is what I've been suggesting to people. Any interest in taking up on that?
You know, the thing, I think Thunder Pussy definitely has a ring to it.
Yes. And but at least people know what it means.
But you don't think, like, Quantum of Solace, people suddenly...
I'm worried that you're going to get an art crowd turning up, that's all.
So, but you should watch the trailer and you feel like, oh, Quantum of Solace, it doesn't sound so arty anymore.
I know, it will make sense to me once I see it. Yes. How lovely to spend time with you. Thank you, Mark. Good luck with the movie.
Thank you, Johnson.
Can't
good
wait
to see
it.
All
you.
Right, bye-bye.
I heard a rumor you'd gone native.
Felix, you get us.
Yes, it is. You know, I was just wondering what South America would look like if nobody gave a damn about Coca-Cola communism. So it would impress me the way you boys have carved this place up.
I'll take that as a compliment coming from a Brit.
Are you sure you're playing with the right side?
Regimes change once a week down here. And then I'm only no dirtier than the next guy.
Oh, you see, that's what I like about U.S. intelligence. You'll lie down with anybody.
Including you, brother. Including you.
And what of the main man himself? When you're James Bond, everyone wants to talk to you. Your anxious boss, implausibly attractive women, and of course the kind of villains for whom sadism isn't so much a character flaw as a lifestyle choice. Happily though, a break in filming meant that I was able to share a little quality time on set with Mr. Daniel Craig, the definitive Bond for our times.
I need a passport and matching credit card.
And MI6 ran out of plastic.
Well, oddly, right now, you're the only person I think I can trust.
That is odd.
But I guess when one's young,
it seems very easy to distinguish between right and wrong. But as one gets older, it becomes more difficult. The villains and the heroes get all mixed up. I was sorry to hear about Vesper. I think she loved you.
Right up until the moment she betrayed me.
Daniel, how lovely to see you again.
Nice to see you.
Thank you for having us here at Pinewood in this remarkable set. Whereabouts are we meant to be? Where will this be in the movie?
We're supposed to be in Bolivia. And this, we filmed the exterior of this hotel, which actually exists up in Chile, in the mountains of Chile, about 10,000 feet at the European Space Observatory up there. And it doesn't quite look like this inside, but it sort of has this feel to it. And we're going to blow it up.
You mentioned Peru you've been to, you mentioned Bolivia here, of course. You've travelled all over for this one, as they always do with the Bond movies. Do you actually get to see the places? Can you go out and visit these places? Is it fun for you, or is it the...
It depends. I've got to force myself out. If I don't, if I stay indoors... I mean, the problem is, obviously, we're filming all the time, so there's not an awful lot of time, but I have to get out and see things. So I at the weekends, I kind of make the time just to go and look at things. Otherwise, things pass you by.
And do you have a yashmak or something you can put on, or perhaps
a
mask?
I do, yes. Yes.
It is a yashmak?
It is a yashmak, yeah.
So even so, though, those...
Sky blue.
Those gimlet blue eyes will give you away, Mr. Craig.
Gimlet blue?
Well, I don't know what that means.
That's good, though. I
think I'm flirting with you.
Again.
last time we were speaking, and it was the build-up to the first Bond movie, and, of course, there was the speculation about, will he make a good Bond, will the film be a success, and so on and so forth. Mm. And, of course, you know, there's no doubt anymore. But I imagine there's a different kind of pressure now.
The success of the last one was extraordinary, and obviously a huge relief for everybody, including me. But that means now we're sort of stuffed because we have to do better. But that's what this whole process has been about.
The Treasury has agreed to stake you in the game. But if you lose, our government will have directly financed terrorism. I will be keeping my eye on our government's money and off your perfectly formed house.
You noticed.
I floated the concept of Thunder Pussy as a title.
Mm.
Haven't heard back yet.
Are you floating it to me now?
Yeah. Look, for the next one.
I'm happy to go with that suggestion. I mean, it just might not be my choice.
Imagine the casting.
Yeah. So Quantum of Solace to Thunder Pussy.
Well, maybe keep Quantum of Solace and the next one could be Thunder Pussy.
Sort of, a.k.a.
Make for a great song, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
It's very exciting for us to be seeing the new Bond movie, of course, yeah. And it's a great cast around you.
Yeah.
I'm very keen to see the actor who's playing your main nemesis in this film, of course, who already has, you know, made quite a name for himself. His last movie was exceptional.
He's just an amazing actor. And he has something about him that you could say is classically a Bond villain. He's got an evil energy, what can I tell you? Yeah. And he does it, and he's using it, and he's playing it to the hilt.
Do you think that evil energy is just because he's French?
I couldn't possibly be drawn on that.
I'm going to stick my neck out.
All right, then, go
and
on.
Say it helps.
He'd agree, I think.
Well, good, I'm pleased to hear that. It's not necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah.
What do you do when you're hanging around the film set? Obviously, you're the centre of this movie, you know, you're the lead role, but at the same time, there must be a lot of time when you're not required and you're still here. How do you feel that time?
Coming to talk to you.
Apart from the fun things.
Yeah. It's really boring stuff. I've got kind of paperwork to do, or the equivalent of paperwork to do. I know it sounds really, really kind of, and then I have kind of meetings and sort of telephone conversations to have. And if I'm not doing that, I'm lying flat.
In the last Bond movie, you kind of took him back to his roots a bit. There was that fabulous pre-titled black and white sequence, and you really got a feeling of, you know, the beginning, of course, and we saw different aspects of him. Are there different aspects of Bond's character that you're going to be bringing out this time that are in the script or that you hope to achieve?
I mean, yes, the answer is yes, but I'm not in any deliberate way. I'm not trying to bring out his sort of softer side. The situations that he's put into, I'm trying to react to as sort of like as real as possible, but also as Bond-like as possible, because we've now got to move things on a bit.
Obviously, like me, and I know this is noted on a regular basis, you're fabulously very fit and respected for your physique. Do you have a date penciled in for when filming finishes where you can just relax and pig out?
Problem is, we've just been in Italy for 2 weeks, and I think I've eaten pasta and bread and pasta
Actually,
and bread.
You are looking
day.
A bit porky.
I am feeling a bit porky at the moment, so. But I think that for my own sanity, that's got to be.
You got to have some.
It's
time
got to be, you know, some cigars, a lot of red wine, a lot of.
Does Bond smoke anymore?
No, no, nobody does.
You have any regrets about signing on to do Bond?
No, none at all. I mean, how could you? There's obviously there's things to come. There's maybe whatever, but that's down the road, and who cares?
It's heartening to hear that.
Yeah, I've got to get on with it. I mean, I'm completely realistic about it. Of course, there'll be someone else playing it one day, and hopefully better than I ever could, because that's the way it should be. So, but I'm just enjoying it for now and make it the best I can.
And when's the next one?
6 months after this one.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Let's say the next one can all be set in South London.
That would be nice.
It's more like the Sweetie.
Is it near you? Oh, I don't know, you're in South London.
How dare you?
I love that.
Of all the things you've ever said, how dare you? You know, you really go off people. I used to think you were quite a good
Bond. I'm warming to you, that's the thing.
Now I'm finding the blonde hair a problem I never did before. Daniel, always a pleasure, never a chore. Thank you so much. Good luck with the movie. Not that you need it.
Nice to see you.
Great to see you.
Dominic Green's going to suck this place dry and then he's going to move on and you're going to be left picking up the broken crockery.
What can I tell you? There's no such thing as a free lunch.
Well, you see, Felix, I don't think you're half as cynical as you make out to be.
You don't know me.
Why? Just because you didn't come alone? How long have I got?
30 seconds.
Well, that doesn't give us a lot of time, does it?
Medrano can't move until he pays off the army and the police chief. Green's bringing him his money now. A hotel called the Perla de las Dunas in the desert.
Thank you, Felix.
Rest assured that Quantum of Solace will be everywhere from Friday. Next week, I'll be reviewing Oliver Stone's take on the life and career of the 43rd President of the United States in Dubya, and a remake of Noel Coward's Easy Virtue, a mere 80 years after Alfred Hitchcock first put it on the screen. Until then, goodbye and thanks for watching. And if, like me, you're already experiencing some Bond withdrawal symptoms, I leave you with a little something to ease your pain. We'll be right back.
It's